from the morning reading. The S&P has set a record for the number of occurrences where the index closing price has crossed the 50-day moving average in a given year. And just a testament to how flat the market has been of late, the S&P 500 managed to cross its 50-day moving average on 3 of the 5 trading days this past week. That brings the total number of crosses so far this year to a record 33, and I think we had one again yesterday, and there's still 22 weeks left. Hello, this is Stephen Harris, a head trader from Falcon Global, where we model best practices for investors, traders, and day traders from entry to exit every trading day. In this daily video, I provide my opinion and insights of the current market trends, market timing, volatility, and hedge risk levels for the upcoming day for the key U.S. financial markets. It is 6:20 a.m. Central Time, and I'm recording this in preparation for the market day, August the 11th, 2015. Full disclaimers are at the end of the video, but be aware that this is for educational purposes only, and only you are responsible for the investing or trading decisions that you make. So let's take a look at our overnight action, and there was plenty. On the U.S. broad market indices, we were weak across the board, with the S&P 500 down about 0.4%, the Russell the weakest at about 0.6%, NASDAQ scratch, and Dow down about 0.5%. Crude oil down a big 1.5%. Euro up about 0.13. The bonds up almost 1%, and gold up almost 0.2% on 110,000 contracts. China, scratch. Hong Kong, also essentially scratch. Japan down about a little less than 0.5%. Germany, big mover, down 1.78%. And United Kingdom down almost 1%. In terms of macroeconomic reports for today, you have the Small Business Index. That's only a yellow. Preliminary non-farm productivity and unit labor costs. Mortgage delinquencies. So all those are pretty minor. On the U.S. tomorrow coming up, we have JOLTS job openings, and of course crude oil inventory Wednesday. If you're a bond trader, note we have 10-year bond auction tomorrow. Let's see here. I think that's
emerging market news here. You've got Sam Harper's Zoom on the wires. He's talking about how the South African economy has been struggling to regain pre-crisis GDP momentum.
Obviously, yesterday big update in the S&P. And indeed, we had a 2-standard deviation move put in by the S&P, one standard deviation move put in by the Russell and NASDAQ. In terms of IV percentiles, look at this, a zero on the S&P.
UK expectation is that volatility has to go up.
It's really hard to get much lower, and certainly your strategy selection should account for increasing volatility, not decreasing volatility going forward. The other markets you see all less than the bottom third kind of situation. Short-term VIX down to 11.44. We have seen lower this year, but certainly is getting to be very, very low. Terms of the skew, only 117.82, so that's also pretty low.
Carlisle rated new neutral at Goldman, price target $27.
Let's see if there's anything else we want to call out there. That should take care of that. And then let's go to our regular daily report for today. IBD status, uptrend under pressure continues. This is now into the third week. Accumulation distribution, S&P is at a D plus, NASDAQ at a D. So both of those are warning signs. GMI index did improve yesterday with yesterday's action to a 6 out of 6. So that's as strong as it gets. But it has been flip-flopping back and forth. And I've noticed the author commented that he'd move to cash with all the flip-flopping that was occurring on his index. So that's of note. Decision point scoreboard, no changes for today, but you see a lot of red here, so that certainly is a cautionary statement.
Iranian
there.
Official speaking to Shauna, Iran's crude oil production levels will not rise until international sanctions are lifted.
Iranian
official
tells
Shauna via Reuters, Iran's crude oil production levels will not rise until international sanctions have been lifted.
First day bullish, but the other three indexes are bearish. Now, the primary signal that we take is from the S&P. It is technically bullish, but it is a first day bullish, and we always take note of that. Oftentimes we see these things of late flip-flopping back and forth, and these first day signals do not hold oftentimes. The other part to this is, notice it's only a 53.7, so why the posture is up, it is up over 50, that does make it bullish for sure. It's about as weak a situation as you can get, especially in context when you look at the other four indexes. Dow, very bearish. And then you have Russell, just literally only one-tenth of a unit away from going very bearish itself. NASDAQ also bearish and almost ready to go below 50 as well. So this is a pretty poor situation if you are looking for long positions. In terms of position sizing opinion, no changes for today. From an investor position sizing opinion, the opinion comes in at a portfolio exposure up to 50%. From an active trader posture, you still are at full position. In terms of hedge warning status, threshold level 1, which is our yellow light or tapping the brakes. So certainly some caution, some risk being invoked there. In terms of, let's go ahead and take a look at our charts. You notice here, we've been in this, of course, we've been talking about it for weeks, this huge range, and we continue to be, you know, smack in the middle of the range, but you still have to recognize that there was a big, big up candle yesterday in the S&P, but really hasn't done anything. So, you know, we had a higher swing low, but we've had lower highs. We kind of seem to be forming something of a megaphone pattern or a triangle in here, and obviously we're looking for that to break, but even if it breaks that megaphone, it's still within the range, so I'm not sure that any of this is terribly meaningful until we do get that eventual range breakout. And given that the longer term posture is bullish, the primary expectation still remains that we break out to the long side. But given the nature, the historic nature, in fact, remember from the morning reading headline that I gave at the opening of this video, we've had a record number of crosses of the 50-day moving average in this year, and we still have, you know, almost half of the year to go. So given the unprecedented neutrality of this market, there is no way to predict which way this will break out. You could also draw a big rounding top here, and you know, could be a classic topping pattern. So there's a number of ways that people are reading this, until we finally get that breakout, we just really don't have an awful lot to go on. That's part of the reason you're seeing so much short-term trading going on. Russell, of course, also had a nice bounce. So right now, this is just looked at as an undercut on the range. But, you know, we've had a couple undercuts here of late, and, you know, that's not good. So this one decidedly weaker. And you don't like it when the Russell is so weak for the overall bullishness of the market. The other one that we look at, NASDAQ, is decidedly stronger than the Russell, but still, you know, after making that huge move on the backs of Google and some others, you know, really chopped around the last couple of weeks, and right now, I mean, what a messy
selling
pattern.
Again, just worth mentioning to the traders joining us from the New York Open, there was a lot of them buying overnight given China's devaluation of the currency and some poor ZEW data from Germany a bit earlier in the session. We are seeing some of those gains just being paired back now as we head to that US Open. It's also a note worth noting today that Brett Hopkins has a big volume, especially in the 10-year US future.
With also some characteristics of what the Russell
pattern
is looking like,
just mentioning that interest in
Asia buyers
and
lower highs and lower lows. And obviously, big bullish day yesterday, but not a great looking set of charts there.
Could you be aware, you've got
back to the daily report. In terms of those various metrics that go into determining the level of risk in the market, from a volatility-based standpoint, the only thing that's really present is a VIX daily squeeze. Again, another warning sign to expect increasing volatility at some point in the future, not necessarily today.
And Stanley, analyst Stephen Roach, multiple China watchers, just doing that at the moment. We're not going to read every single one of his comments, given there has been a lot of analysis on the subject this morning. But those who are interested, check out
the
Bloomberg. If it's something you want to get more analysis on.
S&P 7 is the primary focus that we continue to be looking at. The new high, new low also came back into more normal levels. Nothing to worry about there, so that's a change from yesterday. One thing that did not change is the intermarket risk aversion indicator, still 4 out of 5 flagging as risk off. In terms of special opinions, option income strategies, VIX is inside the acceptable window, but you know, obviously we've got other factors that tell us to consider the potential for increasing volatility. Option income strategies has been the way to go so far this year. Just be aware that it's the way to go until it's not. And be careful that your position sizing and your, addressing the potential for increased volatility.
Okay,
I'm
all analysis rather from the first word team. Just looking at these comments from Finland started a short while back. Remember Finland considered one of the bookish members of the Greece Eurogroup members, I guess. Finnish Finance Minister Stubb says his country willing to consider allowing Greece to extend those debt payments. It's too early to discuss option of Greek debt reduction, he said. The IMF needs to have a central role in Greece's rescue package.
Of a one-to-one distribution between in the money and out of the money strikes and might want to consider position sizing.
€82 and €86 billion, hidden by Bloomberg. EU official Greek program to be between €82 and €86. Just worth mentioning that earlier in the session, we were led to believe that there wouldn't be any debt figure attached to that. And it's worth noting some comments from the IMF much earlier.
Portfolio positions with reduced position size or until after a bottoming pattern forms and it gives you a better signal to start putting stuff in. I am looking for new core put positions, but I will certainly be using position sizing in positions that I am
willing to which estimates
is
going to be around about $90 billion, which is, of course, above the top end of that range, which is given to us by the EU official there.
Obviously, you know, with these record number of crosses of the 50-day moving average, we see much the same kind of situation happening in our market posture where we flip-flop back and forth between greens and reds, between ups and downs, as this has got a very flat set of moving average lines. But looking for some consistency, and very hard to find any kind of consistency in the relationship so far this year. Normally this would be a much easier indicator to use, but when you have flat moving average lines, that is something to note and keep in mind, because when you have flat moving average lines, many, many setups that are classic setups will struggle. And this isn't just choppiness that we've had this year, but it's choppiness with a certain level of volatility. Now, our volatility ratings have spent much of the year relatively low, but we've not had fear, and there's a difference here. If you look at the VIX, the VIX has been, for most of the year, quite low, with a couple incidents. Obviously, we had this little pop-up here in the end of June time frame, and really that's it, for a VIX above about a 17 for the year. So we spent most of the year with very low volatility. Look at the period prior to that, quite a bit more higher volatility action. So we spent much of the year very low, but this action at the same time, when you look at the SPX, we've many times been to the top of the range, and then just a couple days later, bottom of the range, and then 3 days later, 80% of the way back to the top of the range. So it's been a broad range, but one without fear, hence relatively low volatility ratings. But this has also set up a situation where It's been very, very difficult to get follow-through on many of the classic trader setups, many of which are based on various derivations of moving averages, whether you're using Bollinger Bands or whatever.
Just less austerity than previous government, equivalent to 11% of GDP, so Syriza has not U-turned totally.
Off of price action, which ultimately is going to reflect these many, many crossovers that we've had this year. So you've had a very difficult situation to make much out of the sector market postures and stuff like that. So that's always something to kind of keep in mind. Percent change, obviously yesterday was a big day, and energy had a huge day, up over 3%. Materials also up 2.5%. Industrials, 1.9%. And that, of course, healed the one-week outlook. But, you know, in one down day, this all seems to go back to red again. So it's just been that kind of thing. Take a note at the three-month here. There's not a lot of, you know, year-to-date or three-month kind of consistency with perhaps healthcare and consumer discretionary being, you know, the outliers. You know, those have been the most consistent performers this year. So that may be the one place to have safe haven status to a more relative degree. So that's probably enough for today. As always, greatly appreciate you retweeting us to your Twitter followers or to StockTwit followers, liking us in YouTube, all the various things. Support and other comments may go to support@falconglobaltraders.com for the email address. More information is available at the website. Disclaimers, as always, hit the pause button if you need more time to review this. And we'll look forward to seeing you back here tomorrow morning for the market preview from Falcon Global. Thank you and good trading.